Welcome to the first talk of the Distinguished Young Speakers Seminar Series. We are going to be kicking it off with Dr. Marian Hetirashi. And so a little bit about her. She received her bachelor's in her hometown at the University of Calgary, and then received her PhD in biomedical engineering at Georgia Tech and Emory University. She was working under Todd McDevitt and Robert Goldberg, where she was developing microparticles for control of protein delivery. She then recently joined Molly Schweikas' group at the University of Toronto, where she is joining us from. And there she's been working on some affinity-based biomaterial platforms for protein delivery as well. So Dr. Hetirashi was awarded the Natural Sciences and Engineering Research Council, or NSERC, postgraduate scholarship for both the master's level and the doctoral level. And she's also had her hand in several different outreach programs throughout her career, as well as making time for enjoying the food scenes in the different cities that she's been in, and running as well. So it is my pleasure to welcome Dr. Hetirashi. I look forward to hearing you talk.
I was really excited to be invited to this seminar series, and it's been great to see your city and the university over the past 2 days. So today I'll be presenting my work on bio-inspired drug delivery strategies for treating bone defects and spinal cord injuries. So I work in the field of tissue engineering and regenerative medicine. And so regenerative medicine has a lot of promise right now, because of the ability to actually provide solutions for diseases and damaged tissue where there are no cures right now. So there's a lot of different diseases and injuries that result in some sort of traumatic injury to a tissue that really can't be repaired in any way. And so the options for these kinds of diseases are really focused on rehabilitation, and there aren't very many options to actually repair and replace damaged tissues. So this is really the big goal of tissue engineering. And so this is typically done using some combination of the three components here on the left. So bioactive matrices or biomaterials can be used to deliver different drugs or potent cells that can be transplanted into the body to facilitate regeneration. And when it comes down to it, we're really trying to accomplish one or more of the three goals on the right. So this could be replacing dead cells with functional cells that can actually integrate into the tissue, or improving the injury environment so that it actually becomes habitable for cells to come in and repair the tissue, or to stimulate endogenous repair mechanisms. And these are mechanisms that the body already has, but isn't able to use because of the tissue damage that occurs. And so in my PhD and in my postdoc, I work specifically on the area of improving drug delivery using different biomaterials. And so I work specifically on protein therapeutics, asking the question, how can we improve drug delivery strategies for these therapeutics by improving our biomaterial strategies? And so while on a large scale we're asking, how do we deliver something that repairs a tissue, what we're really asking is on the micro scale, how do we get our protein therapeutic to interact with cells better? And so in order to do this, we wanted to take what could be called a bio-inspired or a biomimetic approach. And to do this, we actually had to look at how cells interact in their microenvironment with various proteins. And so the most simple way that this can happen is that proteins can diffuse towards a cell and interact with the receptor and then cause a signaling cascade. But proteins are actually also presented to cells in a number of different ways. So this can involve presenting a cell on an extracellular matrix molecule, such as collagen, or for example, presenting proteins to a cell on something known as glycosaminoglycans, which I'll talk a little bit more about in a few slides. And so this presentation between proteins and the cells actually enables the cells to respond to these proteins better. And this is why we wanted to harness this kind of approach in order to develop our biomaterial strategy. And so when we think about biomaterial strategies, they can be more broadly characterized into covalent and non-covalent presentation. And so the most simple way that you can think about this is the covalent presentation, where you take a protein and you irreversibly chemically conjugate it to a material. And we can think of this as being somewhat irreversible because this protein will really only leave the system when the material degrades. And so while this results in a high local retention of our protein, this can often result in a reduction of the protein's bioactivity. And this is because the protein tethered to some sort of material isn't really the way that the cells will naturally see this protein. And so it reduces the ability of the protein to interact with the cells. So alternatively, taking a bio-inspired approach, we can look at non-covalent presentation methods. So this can involve including these extracellular matrix molecules, or these GAGs, in our materials so that they can reversibly interact with our proteins using electrostatic interactions. This allows us to tune the retention of protein in our biomatrices and can actually have a minimal impact on bioactivity because the cells are now seeing the protein in the way that they would naturally see this in their microenvironment. And so this brings me to the overall objectives of my work. So in my PhD and in my postdoc, I've been interested in engineering biomaterial platforms that can be used to exploit affinity interactions to improve sustained therapeutic protein delivery. And so today I'll spend the majority of my time talking about the work that I did in my PhD, in which we created a material that would exploit the affinity between a protein and a GAG molecule. And this was to heal large bone defects. And I just started my postdoc in January, so I'll give you also a little bit of a preview of what we've been working on there, where now we're actually trying to engineer or tune these protein-peptide interactions to treat spinal cord injury. And so first, in order to understand how we would approach a problem such as large bone defects or bone healing, first we need to understand the problem. And so normally, when a bone breaks, we actually have pretty good healing, and this is the case for small fractures. So in the United States alone, there's about 6 million fractures that occur each year, and the majority of these actually heal without incident. But about 1 million fractures actually result in more complicated skeletal defects that require some sort of additional intervention in order to be repaired. And so what actually happens when your bone heals is this cascade here. And so usually when you have a bone fracture or a large bone defect, we start with a hematoma here, which is filled with infiltrating inflammatory cells and inflammatory cytokines. This slowly begins to heal with a clot, and then this cartilage-like phase in which the cells come in, start secreting matrix. And finally, we get mineralization here, where the cells come in and start to remineralize the defect area. However, what happens with large bone defects or traumatic injuries, or something like a spine malformation, or even dental erosion, this process doesn't actually happen naturally, and the bone doesn't heal naturally. And so we get what is called a chronic non-union, where the bone that forms is actually very unorganized and not actually functional. And this problem is even more exacerbated in conditions where we have bones that actually need to be load-bearing. So for example, a person's legs or the spine, there it's actually important to have very mechanically strong bone. And so there's actually clinical treatments available for these large bone defects already. And there is a protein therapeutic that is approved for clinical use. This protein therapeutic is called bone morphogenetic protein 2, or BMP2, and it's used because it can stimulate the endogenous repair mechanisms of the body to actually take these cells that are in the bone defect and drive them to be more osteogenic or more bone-forming. And so this is what this protein therapeutic delivery vehicle looks like. So it consists of a metal cage or a plastic cage, and in here we have a collagen sponge. And the surgeon typically just takes the sponge and then drips on a large amount of BMP. And this is then implanted into the body. However, the collagen sponge doesn't really have any sort of specific affinity for BMP. And then what happens is that the BMP solution completely leaves the collagen sponge within the first few hours. And you actually get a lot of issues with this. And so this product here is Medtronic's Infuse. And Medtronic is actually had a lot of lawsuits recently because of its infused product, because of all the side effects that people were suffering. So these side effects include increased inflammation, swelling, or bone formation elsewhere in the body. And this is something that we've actually been able to recapitulate in our lab. And so you don't really have to be a spine surgeon or someone in orthopedics to look at this and say that that is not really a normal looking bone. So this is the femur of a rat here. And we're where the bone should be growing is in the center area here. But what we actually get is this huge callus of bone formation. And so, as you can imagine, if this was in a patient, this huge callus of bone is not actually going to be functional. It's going to cause the patient a lot of pain and is actually a huge problem. So when it comes down to it, the problem with BMP therapy isn't necessarily BMP because we know that works very robustly, and it's more a problem with the delivery vehicle. So the question is, can we improve the collagen sponge with another biomaterial that can actually deliver BMP effectively the way? And so that brings me back to the idea of glycosaminoglycans, or GAGs. And so I mentioned previously that these GAGs are naturally occurring and found in the cellular microenvironment. And they have the ability to strongly bind a number of potent growth factors through their negatively charged sulfate groups, which are shown in red here. And so one of the potent proteins that they can bind is BMP2. And when BMP binds to heparin, we actually get an increase in growth factor bioactivity and can enhance cellular responses. So it's as if the heparin is actually protecting the BMP from degradation. So here I just have a couple of images showing that in the concentration of an inhibitor, this osteogenic response, which is blue, is actually reduced in the concentration as the concentration of inhibitor increases when we have BMP alone. However, when we add heparin, the heparin actually protects the BMP and allows it to still induce a cellular response. And so we were interested in creating a heparin-based material that we could use for BMP2 delivery. And we were specifically interested in making microparticles because they could be injected and we could inject them in different doses. So this would allow us to very easily dose our rats with different amounts of BMP. And so to do this, we took our heparin, which is what's shown here, and we modified this with methacrylamide groups, which are the groups that are shown here. And this allows us to cross-link the heparin to make a biomaterial. So this heparin was dissolved in water and then added dropwise to a bath of oil and homogenized to make these tiny droplets of heparin. We then heated up the emulsion to 55 degrees Celsius, and with the free radical cross-linkers APS and TEMIG, we could form our microparticles. So this is an image of what a batch of microparticles looks like, and the pink stain is staining for GAGs, showing that we do have GAGs in our microparticles, and we get about 20 million microparticles per milligram of polymer. So once we were able to reproducibly make these microparticles, we then evaluated their ability to bind and release growth factors. So we were interested in BMP, so we preformed these microparticles, and since the interaction was just electrostatic, we just had to mix the two together overnight at 4 degrees Celsius and we would get binding. And after this, we would centrifuge dried our microparticles and then look at the amount of BMP that was actually left over, so what was unbound. And what we found was that at several different doses, we were able to load BMP onto the microparticles at about 80% binding efficiency. And this was really exciting to us because it was quite linear, quite easy to predict. And also, when we compare our microparticles made out of heparin to other heparin-based materials, we were actually on the order of 100 or 1,000 times higher for the amount of BMP that we could bind. And the reason was our material was made entirely out of heparin, whereas a number of other materials often involve using heparin and another material to actually cross-link it. Next, we looked at release into solution. And so we looked at release of 37 degrees in order to mimic physiological temperatures. And so when we compare the release of BMP from our heparin microparticles to something like gelatin, which can also be used for BMP delivery, we found that our gelatin microparticles released over 30% of the BMP over 4 weeks, whereas our heparin microparticles only released 10%. And so when we think back to our big picture problem, where we want to really retain the BMP within our site of interest, this 10% release is actually a very good thing. Because it means that the majority of our BMP is actually staying within the material. But the big question that came out of this is whether this BMP that's actually stuck to the microparticle is actually active, and whether it can do the signaling job that it needs to do in the cells. And so we used what's called an alkaline phosphatase activity to look at our BMP binding, or our BMP activity. And so I'll explain this a little bit. But what we did was we took our BMP and we incubated it with skeletal myoblasts. And these myoblasts are very unique because if you add BMP to them, they become more osteogenic or more bone-forming compared to their normal state, which is more muscle-like or muscle-forming. And so these cells really give you a way to take your BMP molecules and actually look to see whether it's actually active. So we were able to do this with both soluble BMP and our microparticles. So we would plate our cells down at a high density, and then we would add our treatments, which were either BMP or microparticles, and then wait for 3 days. And then after 3 days, we would lyse our cells and actually look for this ALP response. And ALP, alkaline phosphatase, is an enzyme which can be used with a substrate that originally is colorless and then turns yellow. So that gave us a really good way to colorimetrically analyze the amount of activity we had. So on the left here, I have an image of what these cells look like with the microparticles on top. And normally the microparticles are clear, but we have stained them here with red so that you can actually see them. So we get about 100 microparticles per cell in this assay. And you can see that they're fairly well distributed throughout where those cells are. And then when we actually look at our alkaline phosphatase activity response, we see that at 10 nanograms and 30 nanograms, we get a similar response between both soluble BMP or BMP loaded onto the microparticles. However, it is lower at the higher doses. And so this indicated to us that our BMP was still bioactive. So despite only 10% being released, what was actually on the microparticles still maintained its activity. And so this allowed us to have the confidence to start thinking about how we're going to use this in vivo and how do we actually translate this into a rat. And so Bob Goldberg's lab, one of the labs that I worked in, has a very robust model of bone defect in a rat. And to heal these bone defects, what we typically do is we inject this alginate gel here into this polycaprolactone nanofiber mesh tube. And this mesh tube is basically there to hold the gel in place. And so what I did for my experiments is that I mixed the gel either with microparticles or with soluble BMP. And then I evaluated them against each other. And so we implanted this construct in one of two places. First, we implanted it subcutaneously to actually look at how BMP was leaving the construct in vivo. And this we did with BMP and two doses of microparticles. And then we looked at bone regeneration in a critically sized femoral defect. So here, we actually took our BMP and our loaded and our plain microparticles and then put this in a bone defect to see, can it actually heal bone? So first I'll show you the BMP retention results. So how we did this was we made our constructs and we used a fluorescently labeled BMP so we could simply image the animals over several time periods and then see how the fluorescence was leaving the injury, the subcutaneous site. So this is just the side of the animal where you can see that we can implant two constructs on one side of each animal and then image it through time over 7 days. And you can see here, most obviously, that all of the fluorescence is slowly leaving the animal over a 7 day period of time. When we draw regions of interest around this and try to quantify this, this is the kind of data we get. So you can see BMP retention is slowly going down in each of the groups with the microparticles or without the microparticles. When we take these lines and then fit them to an exponential decay curve, this is where we start to see differences in how the BMP is leaving the animals. So if we get a decay constant, you can see that with the BMP alone, we have much faster decay or much faster loss of signal than compared to the delivery with the microparticles. So this was promising to us because this fluorescent was kind of a surrogate for BMP release, and we were able to see that this fluorescent signal was being maintained in the rats longer with the presence of microparticles. And so we were excited about these results, and then we decided to move into our bone defect. And so in our bone defect model, we make an 8 millimeter critically sized defect in the femur of a rat. And so critically sized means that this defect is not going to heal on its own under any circumstances without any intervention. And so how we do this surgery is that we implant this plastic plate here fixed to two ends of the femur, and then we go in with an oscillating saw and then saw out this region in the middle. So then in our surgery, this is what the defect looks like. You can see one end of the bone here and another here. And then we place in our nanofiber mesh tube. And then we can use these holes here to actually inject our hydrogel. And since the bone is actually fixed with this fixation plate, the animal can still move around and the hydrogel doesn't get squished. So we did these experiments with 1 milligram of microparticles and 2.5 micrograms of BMP. And the entire experiment takes about 12 weeks to complete. And over that time, we can take x-rays and do micro-CT to look at bone volume. So these are some representative radiographs of what the bone looks like after 12 weeks. So as we expected, if we treat with microparticles alone, we don't really see any bone formation inside the defect. When we treat with microparticles, we saw that 3 out of 5 of our defects bridged, which means that you see bone formation throughout. Whereas the other two defects looked a little bit more like this, where we almost got bridging, but the bone didn't completely connect all the way through. Whereas with the soluble BMP, we got 5 out of 5 of the animals actually seeing bridging throughout the defect. When we go to quantify this using micro-CT, we got a result that was really similar to what we would expect from the radiographs. So with the heparin microparticles, we were actually getting somewhat lower bone formation. And so for us, this was a very disappointing result. So we had made these microparticles, we had gone to the trouble of characterizing them and putting them in the bone, and now we were actually seeing that we were getting worse results. And so we asked a lot of questions about this. How could this be happening? We thought that sustained release would be better. Why is this the result that we're actually seeing? And so a lot of ideas were thrown around for a couple of months. Could we change the dose of BMP? Could we change the amount of microparticles? We changed the delivery vehicle, and it was just a lot of ideas to process. And so I tried to think about how I would go about my next animal experiment, but I had really felt like I had hit a dead end, because where can you go from this when you have so many different options? And so we took a step back from the problem and then tried to think about it more as engineers. And really, when you look at a problem like this, this is actually simply a transport problem, so a mass transfer problem. And so we thought about whether we could actually model this situation to try to get a little bit more insight. And it turns out we were able to make a fairly simple model with this in COMSOL. And so we modeled both an alginate domain, which is this shown here, and then the surrounding tissue. And we had actually done so much in vitro characterization and had so much history in the lab from our other in vivo experiments that we were able to get a lot of this information experimentally already and then compare it with literature results as well. So we had an idea of what the diffusion of BMP through alginate was and the diffusion of BMP through tissue. And then we also had an idea of how BMP was leaving the microparticles and rebinding to the microparticles. So the dissociation constant of BMP from the microparticles. And this led us to these equations here, which I'm sure you've all probably seen before, but looking at diffusion of BMP through alginate, the interaction with the microparticles, which is all captured in this equation here, and then also the diffusion of BMP through the tissue. So now we were armed with our model, so we wanted to go back to our in vivo results and try to explain them. So we modeled the two situations that we saw in vivo, 1 milligram of microparticles or BMP alone. And so these are just the three-dimensional reconstructions from the model here. So in the middle, we have this alginate segment. This is our construct. And surrounding it, we have this tissue segment. And what we were able to figure out was the percentage of BMP in each of those domains over time. And so what we saw that the model predicted is when we had BMP alone without any microparticles, we were seeing loss of about over 80% of the BMP into the tissue over the 2-week period of time. However, when we were adding the microparticles, the model was predicting that we were maintaining about 99% of the BMP actually on the microparticles. And so while this is definitely an idealized situation, we tried to take into account as much of the in vivo environment as we can. And the reason that we think that the model was predicting is because we put in 1 milligram of microparticles, so that's 20 million microparticles. And they actually have a very high capacity for BMP, which I showed a few slides earlier. So what was likely happening was that BMP is unbinding from the microparticles and then rebinding faster than it can actually diffuse through the tissue. And so we're actually seeing all of our BMP, or the majority of our BMP, actually stuck on the microparticles. And so we had come in with the hypothesis that sustained release was good, But in this case, it seemed like sustained release was actually reducing the ability of the cells to go into the defect. And that's because cells actually need some BMP to actually attract them into the defect site. And the chances are that we were probably aggregating that response. And so we thought about this a little bit harder in terms of what we were actually going to do next. And then this was actually a very important point to take a step back and then think about the bigger picture again. And so we thought about how BMP is actually delivered clinically. And the fact of the matter is rats heal very, very well, especially in situations of bone healing. And so in a human, you would need several milligrams of BMP to induce the kind of responses that we were seeing in rats. So clinical doses are actually 0.1 to 0.2 milligrams of BMP per kilogram of body weight. So even if you were to take that dose and scale it all the way down to a rat, that's still 30 micrograms of BMP, not 2.5 micrograms. So we had actually been feeling like we were tackling a completely different problem than what the clinical problem was. So the clinical problem was really this heterotopic bone formation. And so at the same time that I was working on this, another graduate student was showing that you could recapitulate this heterotopic bone formation that's seen in humans actually within the rat. And so when you think about it, that's actually the problem that we're trying to target. We're trying to take this heterotopic bone formation and reduce it. And so we sort of framed our question in a different way now. So can heparin microparticles actually be used to spatially localize these high doses of BMP in the rat bone defect model? So instead of trying to reduce the amount of BMP to what could only work in a rat, we're now trying to use something that is a scaled down clinical dose and see whether we can improve the localization of bone. And so now we had our models, so we started off with that in order to inform our future experiments. And so again, we started off with our two extremes. So here we have 1 milligram of microparticles. Again, we see over 99% of the BMP is bound to the microparticles versus our 0 milligram of microparticles, where we have over 80% of the BMP leaving into the tissue. In the model, we then reduce the number of microparticles by 10-fold and 100-fold. And so you can see here, if you reduce the number of microparticles, we only get 80% of BMP binding, and we actually get 15 to 20% of this BMP leaving the site. Whereas if you reduce it even more, we're getting a release profile that's very similar to what we have when we have no microparticles. And so because of this, we chose to move forward with these three groups. So no microparticles, and our two different doses of microparticles. And that was really informed by what we were seeing in the model. And so again, we went through the process with using the same sort of setup, this 12-week study, where we were looking at longitudinal X-ray and micro-CT. So these are the representative X-ray radiographs at 4, 8, and 12 weeks with the BMP. And so I'm showing two sets of radiographs because we actually saw quite a range of responses from the rats. And that's actually similar to what you would see in humans, actually, because some patients will get a lot of heterotopic bone formation, while others will not. And so you can see this bone formation here outside of the defect, which grows over time. And in some situations, we actually saw a ton of heterotopic bone formation here. The only reason that it doesn't grow completely around the bone is because there's actually this plastic plate here, which you can't see on the X-ray. So if we were to add our microparticles, however, we saw this complete significant reduction of the amount of bone that we were seeing outside of the defect site. So with the microparticles, it looked like the bone was now completely localized to the defect site, and we didn't see this heterotopic bone formation. So when we go to quantify this with the micro-CT, here you can see that there's no significant differences in the total bone volume between any of the groups. When you look at an individual micro-CT slice, so this is as if you were looking down the long axis of the bone, this is the region of interest that we were interested in for total bone volume. However, if we were to break this up into bone volume in the defect and heterotopic bone volume, this is where we start to see interesting results. So when we break up the defect like this, we can actually see with the microparticles, we're getting significantly lower heterotopic bone volume, which is on the top, and significantly higher defect bone volume, which is on the bottom. So even though the total amount of bone volume stayed the same, it was actually now all localized to the region that we wanted it to be localized in. When we looked at this further, doing the mechanical testing, we saw similar results. So with mechanical testing, we usually do a torsion test. So we put the ends of the bone here and here, and then we twist the bone to see where it breaks. And this is all outside of the animals. So this gives us a measure of the stiffness and the maximum torque. And you can see here when we compare all of our groups, and even when we compare it to the intact femurs, we actually get no differences between any of the groups. And this is pretty exciting because you can imagine that bone that forms really far out is actually going to have a lot of strength in torsion, but we were seeing the same strength when we had the bone that was all in the defect. So we were changing the localization of the bone, but not to the detriment of the biomechanics. Finally, we did some histology to see whether this bone formation was actually normal looking. And so with our native trabecular bone here, this is just an image of what normal bone would look like. And then this is an image with the same stain of our bone we generated using the microparticle delivery. And so if you look at the pink globular structures, you can see that the structures actually look very similar between the two. And so you can't really see the microparticles in the first image. So if you look here, this is the microparticles with a different stain. And we actually see the microparticles are maintained out to that 12-week period of time. So these microparticles aren't all degrading over the 12 weeks, but fortunately we weren't seeing any systemic effects and we didn't have any effects on the bone formation or the biomechanics. So just to conclude this part of the talk, so heparin microparticles showed a lot of promise for bone regeneration. And so we were able to make this material that could bind and retain large amounts of BMP. And we were able to use it to increase BMP retention in vivo and change the spatial localization of BMP in the bone defect. And finally, we were able to use computational modeling to kind of inform how we were moving forward with our experiments. And that really helped us try to figure out how we could actually solve the clinical problem we were interested in. And so in thinking about how I was going to continue this work and in the work that I was doing in my postdoc, I thought a little bit more about what the challenges there actually were with heparin. So heparin worked really well for our system, but it actually also has some drawbacks. So heparin can bind to a number of different proteins all over the body. And so when you take these microparticles and actually incubate them in serum, which is a component of blood, you can actually see a ton of proteins binding in all these different molecular ways. And we actually did some mass spec on this to see what these proteins were. And it's a lot of BSA, a lot of fibronectin, and a lot of thrombospondin. So all kinds of extracellular matrix proteins that are very large and can actually interfere with BMP binding to the microparticles. And so we had been doing all our release in saline, but when we looked at it in serum, we actually saw that our BMP releases basically twice as fast in serum as it does in saline. And so fortunately, we were able to incorporate these results into our model, and our model actually accounts for this. But it highlights a very important issue when looking at heparin materials. So if you make a material and you test it in vitro, the release that you're getting in vivo is not necessarily everything that you expect it to be. So going back to my overall objective, this is kind of what drove me towards joining Molly Shoykit's lab at the University of Toronto. Because I was interested in how we can actually manipulate these protein interactions with the biomaterial. And so what I would say is that the approach with heparin is more of a top-down approach. So you have a molecule that you know it works, you know it has some functionality, and you now put it into your system the way it is, and you use the properties of the molecule the way they are. Whereas the approach that we're looking at now is more of a bottom-up approach. So now we're taking an injectable hydrogel that actually doesn't really have any functionality on its own, and then we can pick the pieces that we want to give it the exact protein binding that we want. And this is more of a modular approach. So now we're kind of looking at more of an engineering type standpoint. And so I'll give you a little bit of a preview into the work that I've been doing in Molly's lab, which we've been very excited about. And to explain this, I'll first give a little bit of background about the molecule that we're using and now the application that we're using. So now in my postdoc, I've shifted my focus away from bone regeneration and towards spinal cord injuries. And spinal cord injury is obviously a very different type of problem to tackle. So while there are therapeutics for bone regeneration, whereas they don't seem to be working very well, the problem with spinal cord injury is that there are no options for treating the damaged tissue. So patients usually have to undergo some sort of rehabilitation, but there are really no treatment options that actually restore damaged tissues. And so this is definitely somewhere where we see a need for tissue engineering. Spinal cord injury affects over 180,000 new patients annually, and these patients are really only focused with the option of rehabilitation. So there's an enzyme called chondroitinase ABC that can really help potentially with these tissue engineering strategies. So this is a schematic of what the spinal cord would look like after injury. And this is the part that we're really interested in. So where the injury happens, you start to get a lot of cell infiltration and the formation of a scar. And this scar is actually composed of chondroitin sulfate proteoglycans. These molecules are very inhibitory to neurons. So as neurons try to grow through the scar, they actually can't in the presence of these proteoglycans. But we can deliver this chondroitinase ABC, and it can actually degrade the chondroitin sulfate proteoglycans. So by degrading these proteoglycans, we can increase the ability of our neurons to actually regrow into the scar. The problem with chondroitinase is that although other people have shown that it works pretty well, it actually is very hard to deliver in vivo. So this has only been delivered in rats, and the way that they normally do this is through multiple injections of the protein or implanting a pump somewhere else in the body, and it just continually infuses this enzyme. So obviously these kinds of therapeutic strategies aren't really translatable to humans. And so if we could design a sustained delivery approach, this is something that could really help move this into the clinic. And so a pre-med student in Molly's lab has worked with this engineered form of chondroitinase. So this chondroitinase here is actually fused to this fusion protein SH3 domain. And so while the tags on the chondroitinase can be used to purify it or detect it, what we're really interested in talking about here is this SH3 domain. So this domain is very well understood, and there's a lot of literature about it. So in the literature, there's already information about what peptides can actually bind to SH3. And so we were able to have two peptides available for our use, a weak binding peptide and a strong binding peptide. So that gave us the ability to tune the release of chondroitinase from our matrices. So then we would make hydrogels that contain these binding peptides and incubate it with our enzyme, and then watch as the release happened over time and be able to tune it. So we're actually able to include these peptides in our hydrogels in different concentrations or different amounts of weak and strong binding peptide. And this can actually take the release from what it is without the peptide, where we get almost complete release over 3 days, and sustain this release over a longer period of time. And so with the scar that forms it after spinal cord injury, it's really not very well known how much chondroitinase we need to actually deliver. But this will allow us to deliver this over a longer period of time while the scar is forming in order to modulate that scar formation and enable regeneration. And so previously in the lab, we formulated this cross-linked methylcellulose gel here. And this gel was mixed with our different binding peptides. And for this animal model, we actually take a syringe and inject this hydrogel right here into the spinal cord, right above the spinal cord. And so this hydrogel will actually stay in place over the period of time of the entire experiment. And so it allows us to provide sustained delivery through the spinal cord of the protein that we're interested in. And so what we've previously shown was that when we take this protein and deliver it in vivo, we actually get a reduction in the amount of CSPG. So the CSPGs are actually being degraded here. Whereas when we don't have the protein, we see quite a bit of CSPGs here. However, this was just at 2 weeks. So at 2 weeks, when we quantify this, we see a reduction in the amount of CSPGs, suggesting that the scar is being degraded. But when we look again at 8 weeks, the scar is back. So this really suggests to us that this is a very active process, a very dynamic process. And so with delivering an enzyme, we need to think about delivering it for longer periods of time. Because what ended up happening with this study was that we didn't actually see any functional repair when it came down to how the animals behaved. And so while we were degrading the scar for a small period of time, it wasn't enough to actually induce functional recovery. And so this is where I came into the project and trying to think about how we can actually improve this affinity release biomaterial so that we can use it in the future. And so we're really excited about the new techniques that we're planning to use with this affinity-based biomaterial. And so right now, up until now, we've been using these fusion proteins, which involve taking our protein and fusing it with SH3. But that means that we can't buy commercially available proteins, and SH3 sometimes interacts with the rest of the protein and can kind of cause some detriments to bioactivity. So now we're thinking about coming up with a strategy in which no protein modification is necessary. So actually taking the protein and using the protein itself to bind to a biomaterial. And the way that we're thinking about doing this is with something known as phage display. So we wanted to borrow from more biology and molecular biology and actually use those concepts to develop better biomaterials. And so what you can end up doing with phage display is that we typically take the DNA of the different peptides and proteins that we're interested in, and then we'll put this DNA in a phage library. And this allows the phages to express the different protein or peptide we're interested in. And the reason that this is so powerful is that this can be done with huge libraries, so 10 to the 9 completely random peptides or proteins. And so with this many targets, we have a higher opportunity to find peptides or proteins that bind to our protein of interest. So we take our protein of interest, coat it on the surface, and then incubate it with these phages. And then over time, we wash away the phages that don't bind, and we, through several iterations, will actually enrich for something that is highly specific to our protein and has a high affinity for our protein. So this is actually usually used for discovering new antibodies for different proteins, but we wanted to actually use it for a slightly different way. So while they're usually looking for a very high affinity and very high specificity, we want something that has a high specificity, but actually get a library that has all sorts of affinities. And this would give us the ability to pick which affinities we were really interested in, combine them together, and get the exact release profile that we want. And so while we don't know what the exact release profile we need is, this will give us a much better way to systematically test a burst release profile, a release with two different phases, or a completely sustained release profile. And so we think this is going to be very powerful, and we're going to combine this with some of the modeling that we used in order to actually tune this a lot better so that we can get the sort of release profile that we're interested in. So the summary of all my work is mainly that it's based on affinity-based biomaterials and trying to improve them in order to improve the delivery of protein therapeutics. So my first work focused on making these heparin microparticles to increase BMP retention to improve a clinical application that already exists. Whereas in our current work, we are trying to make these peptide affinity-based hydrogels to localize chondroitinase where no clinical application already exists. So this idea would be to facilitate eventual clinical translation into the clinic of this therapy. But what I also want to mention is that the techniques that we discovered along the way are actually very important. And so the modeling techniques that we used and the phage display that we're currently working on are both techniques that don't necessarily need to apply to heparin biomaterials or to chondroitinase or to BMP, but can actually be used for a number of different regeneration applications. And so that's why we're really excited about the tools that we're developing here in the lab. So with that, I would like to quickly acknowledge the people who made this work possible. So during my PhD, I worked at Georgia Tech with Bob Goldberg and Todd McDevitt. And in my postdoc, I'm working with Molly Schoenkett. And all of these lab groups have been really great to work with, and we've had a lot of great collaborators that all contributed to this work. As well as our funding sources have been really focused on the tissue engineering and joining that together with the engineering, especially this medicine by design here. So this is a new initiative that was just started by the University of Toronto, where the government gave them a lot of money to actually develop things like this phage display technique in order to bring labs together and make new cool toys that people haven't really thought about making before. And so with that, thank you so much for listening to my talk, and I'll take any questions.